They have a lot of energy, a lot of kinetic. The energy in motion is known as kinetic energy. Go and check such rivers. They have a reservoir from where they are taking their source. That river is fed from a reservoir. So, for that river to have sufficient kinetic energy to be able to generate electricity all the time, that source doesn't run dry. It's always feeding the river. The same way, Jesus is like that reservoir for us. He's the one that feeds us. He's the one that gives us the power to overcome temptation. He's the one that gives us the power to make wealth. He's the one that gives us all the power that we need. I'm still talking about developing divine mentality. So recognize Jesus as the true vine, our source. Number two, we are the branches. Okay? Always remember that you are just a branch. You are just a branch. Let me ask you a question. How indispensable is a branch to the vine? How indispensable? Very, very easily indispensable. The vine can do without a branch because there are many branches. Okay? There are many branches of the tree. So if you go and take a saw and you cut away one branch from the tree, that tree will still survive. That tree can still thrive. So understand that you are just a branch of the tree. You are just a branch of the tree. John chapter 15 verse 5a. Jesus said there that he is divine and we are the branches. We are the branches. Jesus is divine and we are the branches. Let me ask you, what are the functions of the branches? What are the functions of the branches of a tree? Produce leaves. Okay? Produce leaves and produce fruits. In order for it to produce fruit, the leaves must be spread out to capture the sun. Because in order for photosynthesis to happen, which produces the food that the tree needs, the trees must be spread out to capture the sun. Sun is vital for photosynthesis. Okay? Now, when the food has been produced, it nurtures the tree, and then the tree is able to produce the fruits on the branches. So the branch carries the leaf and carries the fruit. That's why Jesus said, every branch in me that beareth not fruit. Every branch that beareth not fruit. So when you understand that you are a branch, and you understand that it is important for you to bear fruit as a branch, it is important for you to bear fruit as a branch. Then the third thing I want you to understand about the vine mentality is the fact that in order for the branch to function, it must be attached to the vine. Do you understand that? For that branch to be able to produce the food that the tree needs, and then for that fruit to be able to be used to produce the food, and then for the food to be used to be able to produce the fruits, the branch must be attached to the vine. The joy of any branch is to stay attached to the vine. And that's why Jesus said in John chapter 15, verse 5b, he that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. There is no shortcut. How do you bring forth fruit as a branch? You must be constantly attached to the vine. That's why I pity Christians who say, oh, I'm born again, but you know what? I don't need anybody to fellowship with anybody. I can survive on my own. I used to have a friend like that, you know, in my former company. Very, very sound guy. When you listen to him, and the only thing that we're talking about, testing the spirit, that put me back concerning him was when he said that he doesn't need to fellowship. That he's okay on his own. He doesn't need to fellowship with. Ah, I said, no. Something is wrong here. Because how do you abide in Christ? One of the keys is that constantly you give yourself to fellowship of the brethren. The scripture says we must not forsake the assembly of one another together, because iron sharpens iron. What then are the evidences? Quickly, because time is not in our favor. What are the evidences? What are the things we want to see? What are the fruits that the branch needs to produce in order for us to be able to ascertain that this branch is attached to the vine? Love is one of them.
Kindness.
In fact, Galatians chapter 5 verse 20 talks about the fruits of the Spirit. The fruits of the Spirit, those are the things that we have to produce. Because the truth of the matter is that every tree is known by its fruit. Matthew chapter 7 verse 16 to 17. Matthew chapter 7 verses 16 to 17. I'm going to seize that phone. Did you not see the sign? And I said it over and over again. Let's switch off all phones. You don't need, there's no emergency that should take you away from the presence of God. Matthew chapter 7, from verse 8, ye shall know them by their fruits. We're talking about deception in Sunday school this morning. How do you know people who are deceptive? By their fruits. By their fruits. And one thing is that I found out that, okay, men can pretend. Men can pretend for a very, very long time. But it's just a matter of time. There's an adage in where I come from, in West Africa. They say, if lies take off on a journey, okay, and it's been on that journey for 1,000 years, one day the truth will catch up with it, isn't it? One day the truth will catch up with it. Just one day. They say, ye shall know them by their fruit. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but the corrupt tree brings forth what kind of tree? What kind of fruit? Evil fruit. By their fruits you shall know them. Verse 17. Okay, so you have shown the two together. So we understand from this scripture, every tree that is fruitful, number one, we show it. Okay? It may be a bad fruit, it may be a good fruit. But at least every tree that is fruitful, we will see the fruits. That's the first thing we establish from this scripture. Okay? The second thing we establish from this scripture is that the tree is going to produce after its own kind. It's impossible for a mango tree to produce grapes. Okay? It says the tree of grapes will produce grapes. The one that is figs will produce figs. And it says, by their fruit ye shall know them. So what should be the fruits we expect to see from us as believers? Quickly, I'll run through them. Number one is that we are living a life of holiness. Okay? This was the kind of fruit that distinguished Mary for special favor. Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 35. Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 35. Mary was singled out for that favor. For the Lord Jesus to come through her just because she lived a life of holiness. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 16. The Bible says, it is written, because it is written, be ye holy, even as I your God is holy. That's the expectation of God. That's the standard of God. As a child of God, the expectation of God is that you live a holy life. It is true that there are challenges. It is true that it is a very, very high standard. But no excuse is tenable. We are imperfect as human beings. And as long as we remain in this flesh, we are still, you know, we will be imperfect. But let it be that you have a determination and a resolution in your heart to walk towards the mark of his calling. Be ye holy, even as your God is holy. In your business dealings, in everything that you are doing, in your relationship, be ye holy. How do you become holy? Constantly examine yourself in the light of the word of God. Constantly, this thing I'm doing, where am I contradicting the word of God? If you find yourself contradicting the word of God, then you know that you need an adjustment in that area. That's a simple way to live a holy life. Number two, what are the kind of fruits? We are talking about fruitful living. What kind of fruits should we see from a child of God, from a believer? Number two, living a life of thanksgiving. Living a life of thanksgiving. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 15. By him, let us offer the sacrifices of praise unto him who is our Savior. Giving thanks, this must be the fruits of our lips. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips. Giving thanks to his holy name. Giving thanks to his holy name. So when you see somebody that is never grateful, you can already say what kind of branch that is. You can already know that that branch is not attached to the vine. Somebody who's always complaining, never content, never giving thanks, you can say what kind of branch that is. People who are saved, people who are heaven bound, they live a life of thanksgiving. That's one of the fruits we can see. Number three, and you can write down Luke chapter 17, verses 11 to 17, because of our time. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18, it says in everything we should give God thanks because this is his will concerning us in Christ Jesus. Number three, living in overflowing joy and peace. My brother here mentioned it. In fact, go just write Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. All the fruits of the Spirit there, they are supposed to show forth in the lives of the branches that are attached to the vine. But particularly, I want to emphasize joy and peace. Righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Ghost. Kingdom. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost as the kingdom of God. How we know those who are properly established in the kingdom of God is through righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. No matter the circumstances, they are not thermometer Christians. Okay? Thermometer Christians are camelons. Whatever is happening in their environment, they are just to it. Okay? Those are thermometer Christians. But true Christians who are attached to the vine, the environment and the situation around them may be blowing contrary. They will still hold on strong because they know their source. Their source. They know that Jesus Christ is their source and is the master of situation and circumstances, MSC. He's the master of situation and circumstances. And so they are not moved. The trouble is there. They will cry to the Lord in place of prayer. But then when they arise with confidence because they know that as long as they are on the Lord's side, victory is assured. Write down Romans chapter 15 verse 13 because of time. Number four, they live a prosperous life. That's another fruit. Every branch that is attached to the vine, will be prosperous. Third John 2, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospereth. Are you attached to the true vine? And it looks as if poverty is having way in your life right now. It's temporary. Because that seed in you will speak. It's a seed of greatness. It's a seed of prosperity. Psalm 92 verse 12. From where our theme for the next month has been taken. The righteous. They shall flourish like the palm tree. They shall grow like the cedars of Lebanon. The righteous. The righteous are those, the branches that are attached firmly to the vine. They are not living by their own strength. They are living by what they draw from the true vine. And they draw their righteousness from the true vine. Is somebody getting it?
Amen.
Point number five, and the last point. They live is a lifestyle of giving. Those who are attached to the vine, the divine, they live a lifestyle of giving. They live a lifestyle of giving. That's one of the fruits. Very important fruit. Because God himself showed us a perfect example. The Bible says, because he loved the world. Let me tell you, when there is love, there will be giving. The Bible says, because he so much loved the world, he gave his very best. He gave his only begotten son. He gave his only begotten son. You know, they tell you in the world, do your very best. You know, gather everything you can gather. Can them together. In the world, they tell you that the only way to be great is for you to gather everything to yourself. But it's different in the kingdom. In the kingdom, the way to prosper, the way to be rich, the way to be great, is for you to develop a heart of giving. A heart of giving. Give your time. Give your prayers. You know, give your talents. I mean, we've been through so many projects in this church, and projects are still coming. And just watch out. The people that will be testifying of blessings at the end of the year, they are people who are giving. I'm telling you, I'm not cursing. That is the word of God. Luke chapter 6, verse 38. Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measures, pressed and shaking together, running all over. Let me tell you some key things, you know, as I round up this message. Some key things about giving, because time is... giving is one of the fruits of total surrender to God. The measure with which you are giving your resources to God is an indication of how surrendered you are to the Almighty God. Giving is also an evidence of your love for God. Your love for God. How much you love him. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Then, if you love him, give unto him. It is through their giving to him that we are able to know. What are the things that you are expected to give unto God? One thing is very, very certain. And I want to thank God for, you know, workers of the Dream Center of the Godfrey Chapel. 10% of your income does not belong to you. I hope you know that. Who does it belong to?
God.
Your tithe belongs to God. That one does not. So when you pay tithe, you have not given to God. Because you are returning what belongs to him. When you pay tithe. The next thing is your love offering. Okay? So if you pay tithe, it does not prevent you from paying love offering. Because that is an offering now that you are bringing from your resources to say, God, I love you, I give you this. The tithe is his own, you return it to him. But the one that you use to show your love to God is your love offering. You don't come into his house empty-handed. So, tithe, we don't give all the time we come for worship. But love offering, we should give every time we come for worship. Now, currently, we don't take offerings on Thursdays when we come for Bible study. But really, I'm beginning to think, I'm asking God, am I hindering the people from their blessings? Because really, every time we come for worship together with God, we should come with an offering unto the Lord. Then, seed faith is when you now make up your mind. There are projects going on in the church. And you say, yeah, I want to sow into this project a seed. Remember Genesis chapter 8 verse 22. As long as the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest time shall not cease. Let me tell you, when you sow, you will definitely reap. That's what happened to Isaac. In the land of Gerar, at that particular time, there was famine in the land. And Isaac was going to do exactly what Abraham did in the time of his own famine. Remember, Abraham ran to Egypt. Isaac was going to run to Egypt. But then suddenly, God spoke to him and said, stay in that land. The Bible said, in Genesis chapter 26, verse 12, Isaac sowed in that land. So seed faith is when there's a project in the church and you say, yes, I want to sow a seed into this project. And let me tell you, God is not unrighteous. All your seed sown, it will cause them to multiply and to bring back harvest to you in the name of Jesus. So I want us to prepare our offerings because of our time. We're going to just prepare our offerings. Remember the fact that by the grace of God, the month of June has been very, very busy for us. Okay? Remember the big gift. The big gift cost us money. Apart from the fact that we collected some used items from our homes and we brought, the church actually spent some money. We rented a cargo van, you know, rented canopy and all those things. It affected our, entered into our purse. Okay? Remember also the empowerment seminar, it cost us money. Those organizations are supposed to sponsor it, but for one reason or the other, they haven't started sponsoring. And then we are preparing for Canada Day celebration. It's going to cost us money. Then we are preparing for the anniversary celebration. I want you to just bow your heads and talk to the Lord.